Hello everyone, I'm Priya Sehgal from NetApp. So I think the year before last I gave a talk on persistent memory, and that was on programming models for programming memory. And this time actually I thought of talking about the practical, how persistent memory has made its way in Linux, and you know, Linux kernel as well as the Linux user land. So there is a lot of talk about it, and I think SNIA has an NVM group, which was mentioned in the morning, the SNIA NVM programming group, and that has been a key factor in, you know, pushing people around to adopt the programming model and whatever changes are needed, you know, to support it from the kernel and the user land libraries and so on and so forth. So this talk is more, you know, practical. So if you really want to get your hands dirty with some things, so this is it. So this is the agenda of my talk today. I'll briefly go over the introduction, then talk about the persistent memory and its implementation in Linux kernel. Then we'll go to the user land. We'll talk about ZEUFS, which is a fuse implementation for NVM. It is optimized for NVM. And the user space persistent memory libraries, which are out there. So what is persistent memory? I'm assuming most of you know. But just a one-liner. It's actually a device which is attached to the memory bus, very close to the CPU, as you see here. And the beauty is that it is non-volatile. It is persistent. So up till now, we have been talking about persistence, you know, and the latencies which we see is in the order of millisecond or maybe 100 microseconds with the NVMe. But with this, you can get close to DRAM latencies. So some of the examples include 3D Crosspoint from Intel. You have RERAM, MRAM, and so on and so forth. So they are quickly coming up. Currently, there are devices which are actually DRAM backed with, you know, either battery or some ultra capacitors, which are generally used as NVDIMMs. So the implications to software. So one might say that, you know, okay, I have a very fast media, but I have this, you know, decades of development gone into my software, you know, how to access the storage as such. Why can't I just use it and I'll get benefit of the, you know, the latency benefit? But that's not actually true. So this graph here, which was the work conducted by the folks in UCSD, the bar graph here. So what they did was that they had a PCM array created out of phase change memory, and they ran Linux kernel on top of it, unchanged. They issued an I/O, and this is the breakup of the I/O, which is shown here, where the time is spent. If you see, there's a lot of time spent only in the software, and the hardware is only taking around 8 to 9 microseconds, whereas 14 microseconds is spent in the software stack itself, the Linux stack itself. Most of the time is spent in the file system layer, you know, doing user to kernel copy or the multiple copies from the buffer cache and page cache and so on. Because most of the I/O operations are asynchronous, because when you issue an I/O, it's not going to go to your disk all the way, because it's a slow media, right? You'll buffer it, you will send it to the request I/O queue in your disk driver and so on. So this asynchronous nature and the interrupt handling, these are the places where the time is spent. Moreover, the persistence traditionally has been thought of as, you know, accessing devices in blocks, usually 4096 bytes, and not as bytes. So since it's block, so the whole software is block oriented, whereas we have this media which is byte addressable and it is persistent. So we need to, you know, rethink about the way we access and make the best use of this media if we really want to, you know, get access latencies close to what this media provides. Apart from these two implications, the first and fundamental one is that some people say, you know, or are even thinking about how can we use this particular persistent memory as if it's like memory. You know, you just have a variant of a malloc and, you know, allocate some objects and use it like if you wanted to access, you know, have a linked list library and things like that. But things are not easy even in that world, you know. Why? Because when we have objects in the memory, we don't really care about the durability or the ordering of the objects, right? So suppose you have you want to insert a node in a linked list. We never bother about, while programming, we make sure that the pointer is the last thing which we update. But still, you never know when that thing has been propagated from the cache to the DRAM, because it could go in any order depending upon when the cache is being flushed. Whereas in this world, you really need to make sure that when, suppose you are appending a particular node to, or adding a node to a linked list, the update to the pointer is the last thing and it is atomic. Otherwise, you will have problems like your program panicking and, your system not, program not starting altogether because it is in persistent memory. So in some sense, the volatile world was a virtue, but it's not in this case. So I think definitely, and this is a slide from my last talk. So I think I have motivated enough that the software is going to get impacted. So moving ahead as to what has changed or what has been added, before we go there, I'll just cover some basics about NVM and the way we can access NVM. So if you're talking about SAN devices or NVMe and so on, they all have the way you access it or you label it, you call it like a SCSI LAN or you have NVM namespaces. Similarly, we have NVDIMM namespaces. So NVDIMM namespaces are of two types. One is persistent memory namespaces, which is associated with the interleaved DIMMs. So more than your namespace will span across all your DIMMs which are present, and you will not know which exact DIMM the data is going into. And this actually exposes a byte addressable range. The other one is the block mode namespace, but that is associated with a specific, only a single DIMM, and you can have more than one block namespaces. So why we need block namespaces is because if you want to have a software-based RAS mechanism, meaning you want to build a RAID on top of your on top of all your DIMMs and so on, you can very well go for a block mode. But yeah, it provides a block view. It's not really byte addressable as such. So given the background, let's go on to the software aspects. So this figure is like 1,000 words. It's a very crowded slide, and it is taken from the NVDIMM namespace spec. You can find it. I've given the link here. So let me first cover the left part of the management part of the slide. So we have namespaces, the persistent memory namespace, and we have the block mode namespaces. They'll get discovered, or you are creating them, updating them, and so on and so forth. That is the job of your NFIT core, which is the NVDIMM firmware interface table core. So that takes care of the management part, and there are management UI libraries and so on built on top of it. The right part of the figure is concentrating on how to access this media, how to persist things, and make use of it. So the top half, that is in the user land, the three purple boxes which you see, right? This is actually showing the different SNIA programming models which have been proposed. Not only proposed, they're there in the 1.3 version of the programming model, which is publicly available. You can go read it. So the first one is that you want to access the device like a block. There's nothing new in this. You want to access the device like a block. So this application will issue standard POSIX calls for accessing your raw device, just as we were opening in Linux/dev, SDA1, and you get sort of blocks, and you can do read and write. Very similar to that, but it's not optimal. Second one is you want to access the device using a file system, because file system is more feature-rich. It provides you with the namespace. You can have your files. You can read and write from it and manage it and so on. So the POSIX interface doesn't change. And even the file system is the traditional file system, like your ext3, XFS, whatever, unchanged. All of them, all these file systems are working on top of the block drivers, which I'll talk a little later, because underneath they issue block IO, right? So that's the thing. So nothing changes in this world. The rightmost part is the place where things have actually changed. Is my voice echoing? It's okay, right? Fine. So the right part is actually, again, using standard API, POSIX API. POSIX is not gone, although people thought that it will go away. It's not so easy. So POSIX, but it is on top of a direct access enabled file system. So this is the file system which is optimized for the NVM media. So this file system actually knows that, yes, this device underneath is feature rich. It is byte addressable. You can do, it is at the speed of DRAM. So you don't need the page cache and so on and so forth. We'll talk about what optimizations are there in the next slides. This is just a summary slide. So this fellow will never talk to the block driver. It will talk directly to the device or to the PMEM block driver, which exposes byte addressable media. And then the most extreme of all the applications, if you really wish to change your application completely, like for example, you want to implement in memory or persistent memory database, or you want to implement some data structures like B-tree or your linked list, which is persistent. You could, and you don't want to depend upon POSIX, right, for doing the serialization, deserialization. You could very well use the NVM library, which also I'll show you an example. Here, actually, the NVM library just opens one big file from a DAX-supported file system, and then it can directly use load store. So this has also existed earlier, right? We used to just open mmap and then use load store. But the only thing is that this library makes sure that the data is actually durable, the ordering semantics are maintained, and it's not like your data is lost. Because with volatile world, it was okay. Even if the power went off, it would come back, but the data is not there. So you have not corrupted anything. But in this world, it's dangerous. So you have to be careful. So this is the piece from the user mode. Now, depending upon this, SNIA has been talking about it and a lot of discussion happening. So they actually have influenced the Linux, Windows community and various other communities, And as was in the morning, they mentioned that, they are also trying to tie up with OFA and so on and so forth. So in the Linux world particularly, so in this talk I'll be covering Linux, not Windows, there has been support from the Linux kernel as well as the user space. So in the Linux kernel, the green blocks which you see, so the DAX space file system we looked, the other two are the driver support, that is the block window driver and the PMEM block driver. So the block window driver is the driver for accessing your media using the block namespace, which we saw earlier, whereas the PMEM block driver is for the interleaved memory set. On top of it is a BTT driver, which is the block translation table. That is actually from a more traditional point of view. So actually most of the traditional file systems need BTT support. So what it actually means is that in earlier world, at least we used to have sector level atomicity. That is, if suppose I'm writing, your file system is writing or you're doing a raw write, the 512 bytes will either be fully written or not written, even across a power failure. So BTT actually is a software way of providing this power fail write atomicity. We'll see how it is done, but this is the whole thing which I'll be talking in a nutshell and in a little bit more depth. Any questions? Okay, so now let's go deeper into the persistent memory in the Linux kernel. So we talked about the, so firstly comes the drivers. One is the PMEM driver, which drives the system physical range for interleaved memory DIMMs. And to access it, if you're implementing your own driver, from a Linux point of view, you will have to implement something called as a direct access operation. It translates a sector number to an actual page frame number. So you'll be able to make sense of out of it. So all the DAX-enabled file systems sit on top of it. The second one is the block window driver, which we again looked at, which is for the block namespaces for each. You can have more than one block namespace, and you can implement RAID on top of it. So that is what that is why this different names driver is available. The third one is the BTT, which sits on top of both PMEM and block window driver, and it is meant for more traditional file systems, the way I said, right, to protect against stone sector writes and so on and so forth. So the BTT actually is implemented in software. It is not provided by the hardware as such. The hardware doesn't support sector rights and things like that. It's byte addressable. So the way it is done is that it is, you can look at it very analogous to a log structured file system. So all the writes do not go to the same location, but they are written somewhere else, and then there is some garbage collection, things of that sort, which happen at the background. And the last one, which was not shown in the diagram, or maybe to some extent shown, was the device stacks. It bypasses the file system completely, so your user application can directly read or write from the persistent memory namespace as such. It doesn't go through, it just goes to the PMEM driver for the control path, but for the data path can directly go to the device. So these are the drivers. Moving on, the other addition which has been made from persistent memory is the base platform. So I told about that, you know, yes, when you're writing data to your memory, and even here, you will have caches coming in between. Suddenly, the architecture is not going to change. We can't get rid of CPU caches. They are a big boon. They provide the performance benefit. But to make sure that your data, like the linked list example which we took, right, to make sure that the data is ordered and is durable, you will have to flush your caches, and you will have to fence the writes whenever you're writing. Read is not a problem, but writes are a problem. So in that case, CLFlush always existed as a instruction, CPU instruction. But more recently, CLFlush opt and CLWB are the two new cache flush instructions which have been introduced. So CLFlush opt actually invalidates the cache line, whichever cache line you have written to, and you say CLFlush opt cache line address, it is invalidated, and it is ordered across other CLFlush or CLFlush opts for the same cache line. On the other hand, why we needed an optimized version was CLFlush alone, it invalidates that particular cache line. It is ordered across the other CLFlush instructions, but not just for that cache line, for across all the cache lines. So that is why it introduces more overhead. CLFlush introduces more overhead, and there was a need that, you know, if you know for sure that I don't care about who is flushing their own caches, cache lines, but I just care about this particular cache line, you could use CLFlush opt, and if you want to order, just use sfence. CLWB is a write-back version of CLFlush opt, which means that it will write the data to the persistent memory, but it will also keep it in the cache. It will not invalidate it. So it's more useful if you have read-intensive data. Then there is support for, you know, there is a lot of support for the error handling of this media. The Libnvdimm is the very low level or base library, which maintains a list of erroneous, DIMM locations. And if you try to read or write into it, you will actually, the application will get a sigbus error. And it's not like your CPU will fail or something like that. So that's the thing, support which they have added. Secondly, there is a support added for huge memory pages. Here it's more important. The reason being, people are anticipating that you'll have NVDIMMs of the order of terabytes, right? Now, if you want to maintain the metadata for those, for that huge persistent memory, like page tables and struct page data structures, the metadata overhead would actually increase. So that's the reason there was a push and, you know, the introduction of 2 MB and even a gigabyte size pages has been introduced. More than that, the other addition is in the subsystem, mainly in the memory management. There is a new zone which has been added. So Linux kernel, for those of you know, there is a normal zone, DMA zone, and high mem zone, and so on. So there is a specific zone added which tells that this particular area of physical memory is actually NVM memory and not DRAM. And it actually helps in certain cases. Like, for example, if you're doing a RDMA, so it will make sure that the data is persisted and ordered and so on and so forth. That is one of the use cases. There are many more use cases of it. The other one is about the file system. So I showed you in the diagram that there was a direct access enabled file system. So there have been modifications to existing file systems like ext4 and XFS. So the modification is that since this media is at memory speed, there is no need in doing any buffering. We used to do buffering, why? Because the media underneath was slow. It was either rotating media. Even with NAND, you needed some sort of page cache and so on and so forth. So instead of copying it multiple times, you might as well just write into that physical address right away. So that is what is direct access actually means. And that is one of the major things which has been introduced in these variants of the file system, ext4 and XFS. There have been more file systems from like academia, like Nova is the more recent file system from UCSD. That is a log structured file system for persistent memory, and that is completely DAX enabled from day one. So there are certain places where ext4 is not really DAX, wherever they are doing journaling and so on, but Nova is completely DAX enabled. The other modification or to enhance the performance of the file system is that wherever there can be atomic instructions to change a value, for example, your A time of your inode has changed, it can be just be an atomic instruction to change it, right? So there is no point in involving a lot of copies and things like that. So those are some of the optimizations which have been added in these DAX file systems. And of course, fsync and msync is completely reworked on for these DAX file systems. And yes, from the core perspective, I did talk about error handling, and provisioning is something which is taken care of. So this was from the addition which has been made, or the changes made in the Linux kernel. So now let's move up, let's go to the user land. So I'm hoping all of you know Fuse, the file system in user space, right? So ZUFS is a zero copy user mode file system, and it is implemented by NetApp PlexiStore. So PlexiStore is a startup which we acquired last year, and this whole code is open source. Very well, if you have a file system in the kernel space, it has its benefits, performance benefits, basically. But if you want to add more and more features, and you want to be resilient, be portable, and even for the licensing issues, having a file system at the user space is the best place. And that's what Fuse provided us up till now in the Linux kernel, in the Linux space. However, Fuse is also implemented keeping in mind, the slow media, that is the hard drive and the NAND flash and so on. So there's definitely a big gap in the kernel to user bridge or the Fuse, which is available. So some of the places where Fuse, if we compare Fuse and we compare ZUFS, what the features are, Fuse was basically meant for hard drives. It actually relied heavily on caching, page caching, and asynchronous I/O. So the I/O would come from the user space, and it had to be copied to the kernel buffers and then go ahead and so on and so forth. And it introduced a lot of penalty. The Fuse layer itself introduced around 100 microseconds of penalty, and you will have your own file system on top of it. But that was okay in the slow media world. On the other hand, ZUFS is, so definitely we couldn't use Fuse and implement a persistent memory file system on top of it. We needed something new. That is where ZUFS comes into picture, and ZUFS is a Fuse equivalent for NVM, and latency is key there. So rather than going for an asynchronous I/O, it actually heavily uses synchronous I/O. So there's one single core which is picked, the I/O completes, so you get cache affinity, you get core affinity, you get everything, and you get performance. So that's the key. We don't use page caching at all. The access methods are not just I/O, but it also supports mmap. The reason being, you will have applications, maybe you'll have the NVM library sitting on top of it and trying to access it, so mmap is definitely required out there. And we avoid all these overheads like the copies, queues, and so on and so forth. The penalty which ZUFS offers, you'll have your file system on top of it, definitely you'll not get the speed of a kernel-level file system, but the overhead added is only 3 to 4 microseconds, but you have the benefit of being in the user space. So this is a quick overview of ZUFS. So as I said, it's a kernel to user bridge for NVM. The key feature is latency, And for that, you perform synchronous IO, and not an asynchronous one. So you pick up one core and complete the IO. That's how it is. There's no page caching involved, zero copy. So if you have a user buffer from where the data has to be copied, it is copied from the user buffer all the way to your device as such, the page table mapping. So this piece actually, the ZOOF actually maintains the mapping and things like that. It's actually NUMA aware and supports DAX. So the figure here actually shows a few components. So there is a kernel level component, which is ZOOF, which is a zero copy user feeder. And that actually interfaces with the VFS layer and talking upstream to your user level component. Then you have the Zeus, which is the user level server, which on top of which you will have different file system plugins with different features added to it. So Zeus is mainly actually required for the communication with the kernel and so on. It talks to the plugins above with certain function vectors. So these shared objects are nothing but the different file systems. So Zeus and ZOOF already there. You know, we have a GitHub, and we are trying to push it upstream to the Linux kernel. So if you want to implement any exciting features on top of this Zeus, like, you know, you have multiple file systems on top of Fuse, you could very well implement it, and it will work fantastically on top of NVM media. So there are some, with the help of function pointers and all, you can implement your own functions for specific functions and functionality for this particular media. So yeah, so I have borrowed this slide from Amit Golander, who was the founder of Plexi Store, from his presentation. And the link to the GitHub is there in the references. I think you can go take a look at the code. So these are the performance, some preliminary numbers of ZOOFs and compared against Fuse. So what we did was that we had DRAM backed with persistent memory. And we just fired random writes, you know, direct IO writes of 4K size to Fuse as well as ZOOFs. Now, as you see, that Fuse, after, you know, you bombard a lot of IOs, it actually cannot scale. You know, IOPS do not increase, but latency increases exorbitantly. On the other hand, ZOOFs scales beautifully, even if you pump in a lot of IOPS, and it scales very well. It supports a lot of IOPS and with a very low latency. So that's why you don't lose out on the latency provided by this media, the NVM media. Now, going much higher up, so I think in the overall slide, I showed the NVM library. If you are an application developer and want to develop some new apps using this library, so this is the place for you, and you don't really care about the file system and things like that. You just take care of the kernel components. So persistent memory development kit has followed or implemented, rather, whatever SNIA NVM TWG has proposed, you know, the programming model. And they have a lot of libraries which have been implemented. So you can use those libraries and implement your own apps. Only thing is that you will need a DAC-supported file system. So these are the list of a few libraries which are out there. Like, you have libpmem, which provides the low-level persistent memory support. Then you have PMEM object, which provides transactional object store support, and the mem block, which provides block level access to persistent memory. PMEM log is for a resident log. So if you have a database and you want to implement a log for the database, you can use this particular library. And the last one is for the RDMA access. And there are plenty of other libraries which are out there. But I have not listed it here. But you can go to pmem.io and you can get a whole bunch of them. It's all open source. So this is one sample example from the libpmem. So here, it's a very basic example that, you know, I want to just write hello world, but I want to make sure it's persistent. So these are the few steps. First is that you open one big file. You create one big file, f allocated. so that you know you don't hit into allocation issues. You really care about speed, and then you just mmap that entire file, and now you're free to you know keep reading and writing into that file using load store. So what we do is that we use a string copy to that particular address, the persistent memory address. But because we just did a string copy, it doesn't really mean it's gone to the persistent media. It might be just lingering around in the caches. So you have to make sure that it is gone. So that's the reason the library call is PMEM persist. So PMEM persist will make sure that it is not only gone to the caches are not flushed, but also the hardware buffers are flushed. So it is actually persistent in your media. The other way to flush is that suppose you have a lot of CL flushes and then you don't want to be you want to flush your caches but not necessarily your hardware caches, then in that case you can call PMEM flush and then finally call PMEM drain after a few more flushes. The drain will actually make sure that everything in the hardware buffers are also, the NVDIMM controller also has gone to the persistent media. So this is one. I think I forgot the animation, yeah. So this is the a very simple example, but you can build something more, and there are examples on the GitHub of pmem.io, which I encourage you guys to go and take a look. So yeah, that's pretty much it, and I have references which you can take a look at. I think this slide will be uploaded. Any questions?
Any questions?
Hi. So if you're developing file systems.
Can you be a little louder, please?
If you're developing file systems on top of PMEM, so you said there are some libraries, the BTT, which provides similar semantics and probably nothing much needs to change.
Correct, but that is for the traditional, if you're accessing it like a block device. PTT is if you're accessing like a block device.
So so you also mentioned something about something that keeps track of bad areas in the DIMMs. So is that something similar to the bad block replacement or the pool?
Correct.
Of, okay.
Yeah, that's similar. So they have like a, gen disk is the thing, right, for the block devices. So they maintain a gen disk and some PMEM error locations thing. I don't have the exact name, but that is where they maintain the list of all error blocks. And they actually relocate it, or they'll give a proper error.
OK, so if there is any RAID group or such implementations on top of that, we can turn off?
Yeah, you can turn it off, correct. Actually, you could leverage it in some sense, right, on top of?
Typically, BTT. Most of the implementations turn it off so that they
so that you can do better,
own.
Yeah.
You mentioned about PMEM persist and PMEM flush, right? Can you give a little more detail on that? You made you mentioned PMEM persist will flush changes to NVM. So
not NVM. Actually, when it so there are two steps even in the flushing. So when you say CL flush has the only job of flushing it from the CPU caches, and its job is done. But then you have the NVM NVDIMMs. Hardware caches also. So that is what needs to be flushed also. Because if the NVDIMM caches are not flushed, then if the power goes off, you might lose the data. That is why you have to call a NVDIMM controllers. So there is a WPQ, right? I don't recall the full form.
Write pending queues in the memory controller.
Yeah, in the memory
controller. You're talking
about that? Yeah.
But if they are coming under the ADR domain, right? Your asynchronous DRAM refresh. That doesn't need to be flushed, right? That's what I understand. What I understand is SNIA's programming model is, recommending that whatever is outside of your ADR domain has to be flushed out. Once it reaches to your ADR domain, which is like memory controller write pending queues, if that is coming under ADR domain, that doesn't need to be necessarily flushed out.
No, actually, you have to. That was the, I think you can go take a look at one presentation about only flushing semantics by Andy Rudolph in one of the SDC or NVM programming conferences, persistent memory programming conferences. So there is a concept of a deep flush. So from a programming higher level semantics in the kernel, they are introducing a command called as a deep flush. And that is mainly required, and this has a lot of penalty, performance penalty. So what they're saying is that for metadata, or your if your file system is having a journal and all the metadata operations, you want to make sure that it has gone to the persistent media, you better call a deep flush. Because unless and until you call a deep flush, it will not make it. That is actually saying that, yes, I want to flush it to the persistent memory from the write pending queue buffers. So there are commands available for that. You have to call them.
OK, so in this context, you are saying PMEM persist will flush it even from the write pending queues. And PMEM flush will only flush the CPU cache.
And the drain will also flush it, the drain, PMEM drain.
And PMEM flush will only flush the CPU cache.
Yeah, that's a CL flush shop.
Thank you.
Over there. So the Intel has come up with the SPDK device drivers. So when you use the
SPDK, you mean?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that is also, I think, user mode device drivers, which is pulling based, right?
Correct.
So when you use ZUFS, which is again for file system, a user level file system, it needs to be coupled with SPDK to get better performance?
No. ZUFS is a completely different. So SPDK provides you to develop anything in the user land, is what I know of. Again, I've not worked with SPDK. But ZUFS is following the same semantics or the same, exposing the same API is the whatever VFS sort of APIs and things like that, what Fuse does. Only thing is it is meant for the NVM world. That is, it avoids all the asynchronous and page caching and things like that. Okay. It's not using SPDK at all.
Requesting people to ask questions a little louder so that that can be heard over the video.
I'm not aware of anything of the NVMe file system per se, but taking a parallel from our normal file system, say when an ext4 is formatted on a partition, it will keep some space for its own metadata, like sure. A file and its attached inode. So what blocks are attached to a particular file, then that data is stored by ext4 as its metadata. Suppose it's a 8K file, then there will be two 4K blocks, so it needs to store only two addresses of these two 4K blocks. Now, same when it's a byte addressable file system or a device, 8K file size will translate into 8K unique addresses.
No. So that's not how, So we don't introduce, for that matter, be it ext4 or be it XFS or the new file systems which are coming in for the persistent memory, they are not keeping location of all byte. When you allocate, or even when you say, when you actually try to write to a file, it's not that once you write one byte will be allocated. Is that your question?
So, taking again, even a 2 bytes is written for a normal ext4, 4K block is allocated.
Correct. Even here, 4K block will be allocated. So the metadata overhead is not going away. That we understand. It's not possible that store byte level metadata, or even allocated byte granularity. The allocation happens at 4K granularity or whatever. I think ext4 is a variable size. So it'll allocate the extent the way it did. It's only for, it avoids the page caching and wherever there are metadata updates and things like that, where they thought, it is slower media and things like that, that has been optimized.
Any more questions?
So what is the difference between the hardware of PMEM device or NVMe device over a PCI Express?
So PCI Express devices, which are the NVMe you are saying, right?
Yeah.
The NVMe devices traditionally, up till now, they had NAND. Flash. They didn't have SCM, storage class memory. But Intel 3D Crosspoint has introduced a NVMe device, because 3D Crosspoint is actually an SCM technology. It's very fast. Not as fast as DRAM, but I think maybe a little slower than DRAM. I'm not sure about the how slow. So firstly, they have come up in the market with a PCI, this thing. So NVMe over fabric device, which is 3D Crosspoint enabled, and that's called Optane. And after that, they are saying there are plans that they'll move this 3D Crosspoint to the DDR bus itself. So if you're asking about the speed, yes, the speed is different because your interconnect is different, completely different, right? One is southbound, one is at the north.
Yeah.
One is next to the CPU, the other one is over PCI. So that adds to the latency. Even if your media is fast, you won't get that much.
Okay. And one more thing is PMEM, you were using open and then MAP. So that can be done over huge pages also?
Yeah.
That will be
fair. Yeah, okay. Of course. That will be supported.
Yeah. Thanks.
So in ZUFS, the media access driver, the
NVDIMM. Sorry, which one?
In ZUFS.
ZUFS, yeah.
Media access driver, it's in the user space or it's in the kernel space? The NVDIMM driver.
The NVDIMM driver, actually, I'm not very sure about that because I'll get back to you. Maybe you can give me your details. I can get back to you.
Sure.
But I think the driver would stay at the kernel, the kernel level component which was there. But I can still confirm. I'm not sure. Oh, you mean which slide?
The slide had the three animations, mem flush and mem drain.
The slide which had that mem flush and mem drain command.
Oh, the last one.
Yes. Okay. Sorry. My question is on what happens when if the power goes somewhere in between.
Huh.
All these things we are doing to ensure that if in the event of the power going, everything is written correctly into the final device, right? So what happens if between these instructions, execution, the power goes there, between PMEM persist and PMEM flush, or between PMEM flush and PMEM drain?
No, so actually, maybe I have confused. So these are actually two different ways of flushing. So once you do PMEM persist, it has made it to the NVDIMM completely.
Okay.
If the light goes after that, you will see this hello persistent memory. Okay, but here, if once you wrote hello again, and suppose your PMEM flush passed, and the light goes off, there is uncertainty whether you will see the data or not, unless you do a drain.
Okay, so when the power comes back, it may be the previous data or the...
Yeah.
So some other checks and balances has to be put in place.
Yeah, you have to take care. Some traditional things still remain. It's not that it goes away. So okay. The journal also still stays. It cannot go away.
Okay.
Any more questions?
So even here, what is the atomicity of the updates? Is it the entire thing that or it can be
see,
partial.
Actually, internally, the CL PMEM persist is composed of CL flush opt, and then it will do an sfence. So CL flush opt will complete, and as long as you do sfence and there is a deep flush instruction which has to be introduced to flush it completely. So at each level, it's not completely atomic. CL flush itself is atomic, but CL flush and then deep flush together are not atomic.
Okay.
One more question. You mentioned about the deep flush here.
Oh, yeah.
You mentioned about the deep flush, right? What is the instruction for that deep flush?
Actually, deep flush is the higher level API. Actually, maybe not even the high-level API. That's what in the SNIA programming model they are saying. They're calling it. But exact instruction, I don't know. I don't recall right now. I don't have a slide on that.
Okay.
I can actually look it up and tell you right away after the talk.
Okay.
All right. Yeah, thank you so much for your wonderful presentation, Priya.
Thank you.
So